Hi. So my name is Ashwin. So I'm from a company called Proto Central. So interesting thing about Proto Central is that I started this company right out of college, maybe because I was too lazy to find a job. We started out incidentally with projects for the Indian defense. And slowly I got bored of defense projects because you know how the military goes really slow. And open source seems much better. And now we are completely into open source projects. And we've been successful to some extent. So I'm just going to dive right in. So here's what I'm going to be talking about. The reason why we went into medical devices was because we used to make medical devices. I'm basically my bachelor's is in computer engineering, but then I went on to do my I got bored of software, so now why do hardware? So some of the unique design constraints, I forgot to finish that, I guess, unique design constraints for developing countries, because we're looking at open source for the entire world. So some of the extremes on the medical device market right now, then a couple of our projects, then how that is opening up new possibilities. I think that's the most important thing. So right now, healthcare, fitness, all these devices are like a black box. You don't know what's going on inside, but it gives you a signal. The only way that you know that the signal is good is because the manufacturer tells you so. And yeah, there are institutions such as the FDA and who regulate these devices, but their only job is to, I mean, I just found this out recently, is that how to, I mean, they get involved only when something goes wrong. So in fact, the reliability of a device, even an implanted device such as a pacemaker, depends upon how many times it actually failed. So only when it fails, it issues a notice. So I think we have the right to know what they do and how they do it. And that is directly related to, if you don't know what is happening inside, then how do we adapt these things to different environments? When I say environments, it could be different countries, different ethnic groups, different income levels, different resource settings. So some of the design constraints, we've done a little bit of, we've had a little bit of experience with this. So because we worked mainly in India and also some projects in Africa. So regulatory authorities have some standards. Again, coming back to the FDA and other countries' regulatory authorities, but they're not even close to reality. I'll get more into that. The cost, of course, it's not, and when it's cost, it's not just device cost. Cost of consumable, service, repair. Sometimes the repair cost of a device costs more than the device itself. I mean, you might have seen most of these. And this is the third one is interesting, because talking to different people, we found out that some medical practitioners in some places have zero data, zero instrumented data about the patient. They just take a wild guess. I mean, based on their experience, if they don't have experience, then it's probably a wild guess. If it's if they do have experience, then it's probably a more educated guess. And there is this practice of donating used medical equipment from the US to parts of Africa, India, China. And that usually doesn't work out, because you ship a $25,000 piece of equipment from here, and most of the time it breaks down. So what do you do when it breaks down? So the only person who can fix that is the manufacturer. So this is where the freedom, this is similar to what I mean, yesterday Bunny was talking about the DMCA. This is the this is an indirect form of DMCA is what I think, because they don't reveal anything. And also the most important thing to see here is that we're talking about low income countries. So that doesn't mean that there is no income at all. If they're priced at the relevant price point, then it does make an impact. So the only solution is to get creative and innovate, and I forgot to put hack in there. So these are, I'm just taking a quick case study of what is available. So on the one hand, you have the big names. I don't want to name any names, but you can see some names there. So that's the price range, nothing lower than $2,000. And on the other end, you get stuff off of Alibaba maybe. And those are devices that don't have names, but they're still a black box. We don't even know if it is giving us the right readings. But some people are forced to use it because of cost constraints. And everything says it's approved, but that's a very relative term. And there is no documentation. So if something happens, cannot do anything, or you don't know the reliability of this. So this is where I've taken this as an example of how open source here can help. So if you have an open source patient monitor, for example, an open source patient monitor, you can independently verify the accuracy if in doubt, get it certified if required, calibrate it yourself, no manufacturer calibration and all that, generic consumers. And since there is the open source community available to support this stuff, the software is constantly updated, and I mean, not just software, hardware, everything. So it kind of builds on that. So look at it as two things. Instead of having something like that, provide some vital information where nothing is available. So this is one of the products that we launched on CrowdSupply last year. This is based on a Raspberry Pi. It's got all these parameters and the bill of materials, if you really want to do it in bulk, is pretty cheap. And all the hardware, software, everything is open source. You can, I don't know if you can see the bottom of the screen, but you can go to our GitHub site and download mostly everything for this. And it's also available on CrowdSupply. So this is the board. It sits at a hat for the Raspberry Pi. The reason we chose a Raspberry Pi is, before the question comes up that Raspberry Pi is not open source, the reason we chose that is because it's the cheapest one available and in every corner of the world, not just here. Even in India, that's probably the most highest selling board. So we decided to use the Raspberry Pi. So this is the hat. So it's based on a SAM D21 chip. So we tried to use mostly standard components, because if you put a SAM D21 on there, then that's the same chip that is there on an Arduino Zero. So you can put the Arduino bootloader on it and you can program it using Arduino. And we've got something for pulse oximetry. So we try to integrate components as much as possible. So we have something for pulse oximetry and something for the ECG and respiration together. And there are some off-board connectors for connecting an external temperature sensor. That temperature sensor could be an analog sensor or a digital IR-based sensor. We use stereo connectors mostly as far as possible, because one thing that we learned in the medical industry is that connectors are very, very expensive. I mean, a set of connectors for a patient monitor could cost up to $1,000 each. And I don't know what, if the cables are made of gold or something, but I don't think they are, but it costs that much. So you can pretty much hack into any part of this at any level. I mean, if you want to program it with an Arduino, you can do that, or you write your own native Atmel code. And it's also got USB. So it can be used without a Raspberry Pi also. I mean, it can stream data through that USB port. So this is what the data looks like. This software is also open source. It's got some filters and some algorithms built in that can measure can take the ECG and the respiration waveform and turn it into heart rate and respiration rate and SpO2. So this was written in processing. We love processing. I mean, we use it for everything, mainly because it's cross-platform and it's just easier to do things. So we still use processing, but there is a version that we are making using Python for the same thing. So this is an interesting thing that happened. This is a stall that we had at Maker Faire Rome. And that's when we actually realized the complete educational value of this thing. I mean, first we started designing this as a patient monitor, but then there was also the other aspect. How do we build these things? How do these things work internally? So you can see here that a lot of kids were trying out. We had some displays on there where you could put your hands there and it will show you our actual ECG. So what we learned is that when kids come and use it, and instead of looking at some signal, they look at their own ECG, it makes even more stronger point. And that was really helpful. So there have been now, after Maker Faire Rome, we've had a lot of education institutions contact us and see if they can be made available for their teaching purposes. So not just as a patient monitor. So for example, one could just use only ECG. So you just program it, since it's all hackable anyway. So you just program only ECG, and you probably want to write a lot of algorithms for it. You can do that. So education is also very important. So this is another project. It's a heart rate variability monitor, which is, it's not a heart rate monitor. It's a heart rate variability monitor. Maybe I won't go into the details here, but it measures the time between individual heartbeats and uses that time information to do a lot of other stuff. So I'll be going into the detail about this during my workshop. I think it's at 4 o'clock. So if you're really interested in how this thing is built, you can come there. So I'm going to skip this slide. So some points about heart rate variability. That's the ECG waveform that you see over there, and the time between the peaks is called the RR interval. And so when you plot those intervals, that's a difference plot where those two things are individual successive intervals are plotted against each other, and you can see. So it's used for a lot of other things besides cardiac monitoring. It's totally. So some interesting studies are here, and people say that you can do a lot of things with the HRV. Some are true and some are not. Some are just claims, but most of it is true. I mean, there's been even evidence to show that certain forms of cancer is reflected in HRV. And that is true to some extent, which I'll go through in detail later. So this is how HRV works. I mean, it's an indirect measure of the autonomic nervous system. So there are two nervous systems and the balance between them. And maybe I won't go into the detail unless you want me to. But one causes the heart rate to increase, one causes it to decrease. So depending on, so it's like your heart rate is not exactly the same each time. So when you see what you see on a Fitbit or the heart rate monitor is nothing but an average thing. So if it's exactly the same every time, it's probably not a heart. It's a metronome. So if it's exactly the same, then it doesn't work like that. Or it could be that you're having an arrhythmia. So this one part of the nervous system, which is a response, which is responsible for the fight or flight response, that's what keeps us on the edge, increases the heart rate. And the read and digest, this is what keeps us sane. I mean, not always on the edge. So this increase and decrease is reflected in the heart rate variability. So I'll go through in detail later. So, okay, I think this was, so this is what it looks like for different, so we actually recorded actual data using the Hearty Patch. So just to quickly explain, this is what different types of actual cardiac arrhythmia look like, just based on RR intervals. I mean, there are several ways to find out what's wrong with your heart, but the simplest way is using just a patch. Right. So we have some of these devices. I mean, you're welcome to come and see them. So this is an interesting board. I mean, this is the, it's based on an ESP32, so which I'm sure most of you are familiar with. And we started with ESP32 because that was the cheapest one around. And it's got a PCB antenna behind this text. So this was one of the earlier ESP32s, so we had to have the flash chip outside. But the latest version, this is, we went through a lot of revisions on this board before we came here. This is, I think, version 2.3, although it says 2.1 here, it's 2.3. So the 2.3 is about the 7th or the 8th revision. So these two connect to regular ECG electrode pads, which stick to your body. And there's this cool chip called Max from Maxim, Max 3003. I think this is key to our product, because this thing can actually run algorithms on the chip itself and give you the real-time beats. Like whenever the heart beats, it gives you an interrupt. It can't get simpler than that. So that takes a lot of load off of the processor and puts it on the chip. And that algorithm is surprisingly very accurate. So you can measure the distance between heartbeats. When I say distance, the time, in millisecond accuracy, which is really required for heart rate variability. Otherwise, it's just average heart rate. So we got an LED here, one of those RGB LEDs, just to change color depending on what happens. And the rest is kind of straightforward. This is the new version. And it doesn't look like much here, but because I took this picture yesterday in my hotel room, so it's not very clear. So if anybody wants to see, I mean, I have it with me here. So we've made it really smaller because we got complaints that it was so big that it started pulling on people's skin. So then this is really light. And so ESP32 is a great chip, but it supports Wi-Fi and BLE, everything else. But the thing with that is, as of the current release, that is 3.0, it does not yet support actual BLE. it supports BLE in theory, but the power consumption remains the same. So it doesn't really go to sleep when it's supposed to go to sleep. So you give sleep and then it just ignores that command. So I think that is something to do with, I've been in touch with the Espressif team. They're great, especially Sprite. They're pretty great at it, but they apparently have a problem with the stack, the Bluetooth stack that they're using. So he promises that it'll be fixed by 3.2, and I don't know the date for 3.2. So meanwhile, we could not wait for 3.2 to come around. So we've switched to Nordic NRF52. It's Bluetooth 5, and the main thing about Nordic controllers is that it's very, very, very low power. So this thing works on 100 mAh battery for about a week, and power management is so granular that you can control each and every millisecond so good. So we had a lot of trouble setting up the NRF development environment, though that's not very user friendly, but it worked. So other than that, it's the same chip. The battery covers most of it, but it's not intentional. I can show it to you later. So I just want to quickly, this was the main thing, I mean, that I wanted to tell you. So we made this device, we put it open source, we sold it through crowd supply, and then things started happening. So people bought it from crowd supply or built their own. Some people even built their own. I mean, they made their own PCB, they assembled it, and then they showed it working. And that led to a totally new applications. So before I go into one of the applications, this is a fact related to fetal death. So fetal death is a huge problem in countries, and if you see, number one is India, where I'm from, so it's not so great, and number two is Africa. And sadly, these are preventable deaths, in the sense that these are deaths that occur during labor, so we are just addressing the deaths during labor. So what happens during labor is, I mean, the fetus position could be different, or so many things could be going on, but in hospitals, in big hospitals, or even in the hospitals where I'm from in Bangalore, they have these huge machines that cost a lot, and they do fetal ultrasound and all that, and it calculates if the baby's heart rate drops and all that. But what about the other half of the world, or even the other half of the country? So this is a project that we collaborated with a group out of Harvard, and so this is how it worked. They saw Hardy Patch, they knew what it could do, and they thought, okay, let's get it from crowd supply and do something else with it. And that was the magic that I thought was really amazing. So the goal is what I already explained, except there are some, it's mainly fetal hypoxia. And so we wanted a very low-cost solution to get ECG from the belly, right? And not just ECG, contractions and a lot of other things. And they, Doug Williams is the guy who wrote the Python code for all this stuff. And the solution is relevant only if it is affordable. So our entire goal was to make this entire system for $50. That was the goal of the project. And this project was supported by the Gates Foundation grant, USAID, for Africa. So only part of the grant, I mean, we worked on it pro bono. So what Doug did is that you can still see that it's still the same heart device that I have here, but he hooked it up to some different kinds of electrodes, put it on the tummy during labor, and guess what? It started picking up uterine contractions, and they were really happy about that. So then they contacted us and saying, hey, we've done this, can you help us with this project? So so the next step was, so we wanted a list of parameters. We wanted fetal heart rate and uterine contractions and maternal heart rate. I mean, the basic three parameters, and there are more, but let's keep our wish list very small. So we went ahead. It's still in Eagle because we haven't sent that board out yet. But what we did is the green thing that you can see there is nothing but. So this is another example of repurposing what is already available. You get one of these ultrasound scanners from AliExpress for $25, which you can just listen to. You can listen to the fetal heart rate and see if there is a sound and all that. So we hacked into that. We got the audio output out of that, fed it into our ESP32 on the hearty patch, and now we have a complete system, which is called Toko patch. Toko means birth. So another patch was born out of this. And we just had our trials a couple of weeks ago in Malawi, where the Gates Foundation has established a facility, Blantyre. And we got pretty good data. So this is some of the heart rate variability data. I mean, I won't go into detail, but here is different versions. So the total output of the system is to simplify things. So the main constraint here is, one is, of course, there is no equipment. No, I think that is number two. Number one is there are no obstetricians. There are no doctors at all. So it's just nurses or midwives who are there during labor. So for them to read just a color code. Green means okay, yellow means not so okay, that means do something about it. So the do something about it part is very interesting, because most of the time what they found out is that it is as simple as, not everything requires a surgery immediately, it's as simple as telling the mother to just roll around. And because there is this small fetus inside and it's just floating around in this thing, and just changing the position can improve things. And just, I was really surprised that something so simple can result in a loss of life. So other applications, this is something that I picked out after for a Hackaday page. Interesting applications. One guy wanted to build a sniper heart rate monitor. I didn't know what that was. So I found out that he wanted to use the hearty patch to find out when exactly the heart beats, so that when he is sniping, the trajectory doesn't change. So apparently they train for it. So this is a totally different thing that I wouldn't even have imagined. Right? So these are all the applications. So this is a new application. This is also another project that came out of Hearty Patch. So scientists do these mice-based experiments always. And I'm not in the biological field, so I don't know anything about it. But I was just introduced to it. And this happened because I don't know if Josh remembers that in one of the conferences, a guy came up to me and asked, can you put this thing on mice? Okay, so that got us thinking, okay. And it so happened that in the same week, another guy came and asked, can you put this on mice? So that means there's something there. So, and then we thought, okay, let's try that. So we went through a lot of things. First thing is, I did not get access to mice. So all I had was this 3D printed mice. And so we used this for all our dimensional requirements. So we just made, so the result is, apparently the impact is pretty big. And you get more reliable data, because right now the experiments, how they happen, I was really surprised to hear this, and this is from one of the top labs in the US, is that they literally inject the mice with some drug, for example, for a toxicity studies. They inject it with a drug, and a PhD student literally sits there and waits until the mice dies. And that's how they do science right now. They do not have anything that can instrument the vital signs of mice, which was very surprising for me to hear. And that too from one of the top guys here. I mean, I'm not allowed to say their name, but they're in Boston. So, and better animal care also. I mean, you don't have to, the newer, they have new regulations. There's something called IACUC, and things get really messy. So we made a flex version. So this is the same thing as an RT patch. It doesn't look so nice because we haven't cleaned it properly. Again, this was from my hotel room. So this is a pretty brand new project. I just came back from testing last week. And it worked in the sense that, so this goes around the mice, as you can see here. It touches the underbelly of the mice where it's got some ECG pads, and it's got an SpO2 sensor here, and it's got temperature, it's got some accelerometers to monitor all these things. So this was my first time doing flex PCBs. So it took like 3 or 4 iterations before I got here. It got really expensive than I thought. And this project was not funded at the time. Okay, sure. So this is the mice, and maybe I'll present this at the workshop. So we got mice, and I'm not allowed to show the video also. So common questions asked, I'll just quickly go through this. I'll skip the technical questions, but the other questions is, why does it not have a patent? And I said, why should it? Why does it not cost $2,000? And again, why should it cost $2,000? Is there something wrong with it? But we got the same data. So that brings us to the next thing. I mean, there are regulatory issues, of course. I mean, this is a slide from one of my previous presentations, but ignorance of the risk can prove fatal. Right? I mean, depends on what you have. And there are always false positives and false negatives. You make interpretations based on the outcomes, mostly wrong. And you don't want your doctor looking like this, right? So that's misdiagnosis. But still, how do we... These things are still there, but how do we... still make open source medical devices? I mean, that's a completely different issue that maybe I can discuss later during the workshop, but I like this statement. If the Trojan horse was made of glass, would the Trojans have rolled it into their city? Probably not. So this is, I think, the perfect definition of open source. I didn't say this, some guy from FOSS, and I think it's pretty widely used. So when you know what code goes into your software, and this is a security question, answering to the researchers. If you know what goes into it, you know what software runs on it, you know how to secure it, and you know how to use it. So hardware could save lives. That's it. Thanks. So I don't think we have time.
Yeah, we're gonna